Hey everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson, here this week just with Humphrey, and hopefully a list of interesting cards for the new standard that we're looking at. I would say on the verge of Magic Weekend, but Magic Weekend's kind of going on as we speak. The big question that was on my mind leading up to this event, and hopefully a lot of our viewers, was what is Team Fireball playing this weekend at the PT? Now, obviously in the weeks to come, we're going to be seeing a lot of articles where these guys talk about their performances, talk about the testing, so I'm not going to go over that, especially because I wasn't involved. What I do know, and what is my specialty, is cards. What's going up, what's going down, and why. Now, the best way to start this is when Luis and I are usually wrong. Well, not usually, especially when it comes to Luis, who would never admit being wrong about anything. But Sword of Feast and Famine, a card that when we previewed it, we were like, it's kind of an inferior sword. It's not on the same level as Sword of Body and Mind. You're not going to play with it, but you don't get a dude. Its impact is really great. However, the saving grace when we did talk about it in previews was that it has Pro Black, which is a pretty big deal right now with all the Go for the Throats / Doomblade still being played. So going into the PT, playing a blue-white kind of control deck that also utilizes Stoneforge Mystic to get a card like Sword of Feast and Famine has looked actually really strong for the team. In combination with Squadron Hawk to be card advantage and Stoneforge Mystic to be tutoring and card advantage, to then slap Sword on top of all of those things to get more card advantage out of the fact that you're making your opponent discard a card. This is usually where Luis would jump in and talk about value and how he only plays cards for value. And Sword really does that. Having protection from kind of, you know, one of the two key removal colors, as well as pumping your guy, hopefully, out of bolt range, depending on who you put it on, although it goes on Squadron Hawk a lot of times, so you're not necessarily out of the range of Slagstorm or Lightning Bolt, but you get a lot of value out of that combination. The ability to discard, make your opponent discard their hand is sweet in the control matches. So that interaction, that card is already going to be hit this weekend. Obviously, Stoneforge Mystic, even more so. It's already in the Boros decks, it's already in the Quest decks that exist already and will be played this weekend, but now you've got it in this new kind of control shell that plays equipment and creatures, which is like kind of a cool concept. You obviously still have control cards like Spell Pierce or even Day of Judgment in that kind of deck. If you remember Craig Wesco's tricked out white weenie from a year ago, where a white creature deck could still bounce back from a Wrath effect, especially if the player that has all the threats in the kind of deck with those creatures can still play with your own Day of Judgment to know when to use it. So that's pretty cool moving forward. Also, we just touched on the fact that we've got Kadalthe red decks, we've got Boros decks in Standard. For me, the big sideboard card that might be a main deck card moving forward that's conveniently an artifact is Ratchet Bomb. Being able to destroy all the Goblin tokens, all the Memnites, all the Ornithopters, if they're still around there at the zero cost, is already pretty good considering how sweet Kadalthe Rebirth is right now. Hitting on one, you've got your Signal Pests, you've got your Goblin Guides, your Clint Hawks, your so on and so forth, the list goes on. 0, 1, and 2 on Ratchet Bomb is really key. It's in a lot of sideboards for this weekend moving forward. Could it be in some main decks? We can kind of connect that to Tezzeret. Tezzeret being obviously playable in Constructed. You're seeing it buddied up right with Jace, just as we kind of assumed. Really choosing the numbers is kind of the interesting thing. Again, Luis and I have touched on the fact that, you know, one isn't replacing the other. It's not like I had a deck with 4 Jaces, well now I'm gonna put artifacts in my deck and play 4 Tezzerets. I think finding a combination of these cards, I mean, obviously Planeswalkers work really well together. These work very well together. Oh, just conveniently put this artifact on the top of my library, then I'll draw it and put away a couple, you know, one other card that maybe isn't so good, or just put away 2 cards with Jace and then into Tezzeret that aren't as good. Those are decks. I mean, we talked about Sphere of the Suns, Inkmoth Nexus with Tezzeret. Those seem kind of obvious. Now you get another artifact in Tumble Magnet, which has uses of a certain type at first, and then, hey, it can become a 5/5, even better. It's pretty exciting to watch that interact, and odds are we're going to see Tezzeret do a lot of work in the near future. So tying it all together, Stoneforge Mystic, Sword of Feast and Famine, they're already kind of on the rise. Those are cards to look for in Standard. I'm a huge fan of Ratchet Bomb. It's kind of been a sleeper in the past. I mean, its value has kind of waxed and waned quite a bit, but I think it's going to be pretty strong moving forward, mostly because of those aggro decks, but then also playable with Tezzeret. So then looking at the other kind of edge of the triangle, you've still got the Boros decks, the Kadalthe Rebirth decks, which thanks to Star City Games, the Indie Championship, which was, or event, or whatever you want to call it, 64K or whatever, That'd be pretty sweet. 64K tournament. Gadotha Red is very much a deck. Signal Pest, Contested Warzone, those are cards to look for to be strong. And I've talked about it in other forums. Like, at this point, I've done so many podcasts and other shows at this point, I don't remember who I've told what to wear. But Contested Warzone is obviously a sweet card. It's more than that, like, $1.50 it was spoiled at. I mean, I think Channel Fireball, as we speak, is probably selling them for, like, $8 a piece. And that was because it might be a 4 of in a lot of aggressive decks. Kadotha Red's pretty obvious. But could Boros run really one 4 of it? Could a white weenie deck run 4 of it? That's the real question. And the other thing is, if enough of these decks are the metagame, is it going to be kind of, do you really want to run 4 of each? If your opponent has one, it's like, well, I go, you know, turn 1, you know, Memnite into Rebirth, turn 2, War Driver, or, you know, and then I'm attacking, my opponent has a Contested Warzone, well, now I got it, and he has to come back on the back foot because I went first. I mean, is it something you really want to run 4 of in all those decks? So the numbers might be shifting, maybe not, depending on how much we see of those really aggressive strategies, but it's still a good card in Standard moving forward. One card that I've been kind of joking about recently, but I'm pretty stoked to see is already seeing some action at the Pro Tour, was Mass Polymorph. Granted, I was trying to be a little more tricky about it because I was like, you know, it started with Massacre Worm, and I was like, I don't really think this card is going to see play in Standard. I mean, Luis and I talked about how Grave Titan's probably better 8 or 9 times out of 10 right now, it feels like, when playing a black-based control deck. Because obviously, blue-black control is still a deck. I mean, is Massacre Worm going to fit into that deck somewhere, maybe in the sideboard? I don't know. But I was like, there's got to be a home for this card. And so I've been joking in the last week that I was like, you know, I really want to, like, Mass Polymorph into, like, quad Massacre Worm. Or, you know, 3 or 4 Massacre Worms, like, how sweet is that? You're obviously going to kill everything on your opponent's board. And it's, there are, you know, since all of your Massacre Worms are in play at the same time, they're going to lose a lot of life from that effect. It's not necessarily game-winning. I mean, obviously, if you hit quad Massacre Worm and your opponent has 3 guys in play, that's game. But that's not super easy to set up. But what was interesting to me was that there were actually quite a few cards that made Mass Polymorph work, and they're not the ones we'd been seeing prior. You don't necessarily have to play all the Growth Spasms, all the Awakening Zones, or the Colony Gardens that you kind of assumed you did in the past when this card was first spoiled. I mean, between Elspeth Tyrell and Master's Call, you actually have a couple of new ways to make creatures without them having to be out of the green kind of token generating you're used to. And white has a lot more control options, as well as Ink Moth Nexus, obviously. We see that card coming into many different decks. It's as good as advertised. So I think the tools are really there. I mean, maybe, I mean, you're not going to put Massacre Worms into play. Maybe you're going to put something else. But Mass Polymorph is still very much a card that's going to do something. And it's going to be there. I mean, whatever combination it is, if it's Ink Moth Nexuses, if it's Colony Gardens, is it Growth Spasms or Master's Calls, I think moving forward, that's going to be a viable strategy. It's going to be something that is going to keep players honest in kind of the mid-range decks. And maybe kind of looking at Valakut, like moving over to that area. We've got Green Sun Zenith. We've hyped it up a whole lot. We're going to see it this weekend. That and probably Elves are going to be the decks where it's going to be the most effective. But watching its versatility, watch it being, you know, played, like, are you going to play around Spell Pierce? Are you not? Are you going to have toolbox effects in your deck? Are you not? Are you just going to keep running the A plan and run some number of Zeniths? That's really kind of the question. I'm not sure. I think that this card was very hyped going into Magic Weekend. It's obviously good, but, you know, is it going to be fast enough? Is it going to be strong enough? I mean, we obviously know it's versatile enough, but that's my question moving forward, because there isn't a whole lot else to kind of adjust the look of, especially a Valakut deck. I mean, in Eldrazi Green deck, there are a few more options, but that's pretty much the only card that's, like, you know, new in that kind of combo. I mean, obviously, Slagstorm is still, you know, really good, but it doesn't, you know, it doesn't part of, like, the curve that makes Valakuts come into play, which is actually good to stop on Slagstorm. I don't remember whose deck I was looking at. It was Grixis from the PT right now. But I think Slagstorm could be fit into a lot of decks. I mean, obviously, it's a Jace answer. It could be a Tezzeret answer at the right time, although that guy appears to be coming into play at +1-ing. if he isn't, if he's minus one, he's making a 5-5, you might have bigger problems. But being able to get rid of all of those goblin tokens, all those goblin cards, a lot of the Boros creatures, assuming they don't have stacks of equipment or things to make their guys larger, seems like it's going to be really relevant. Kind of a wrath effect for 3 mana, not 4 mana, the fact that it's red. Like, I'm really surprised we haven't seen Slagstorm kind of attached more to Koth. It seems like it could be kind of a natural curve if in kind of a big red deck or a metal-crafted red deck, you would be able to disrupt those early Kadatha, Boros, you know, white deck plays or goblin or elves plays with turn 3 Slagstorm into turn 4 Koth. Haven't seen it much. And, you know, where's the Koth on all these things? I mean, forecasting cost planeswalkers are good. We all know it, as long as your name isn't Sarkhan Vol. Where's that guy? I mean, is he going to emerge? Maybe, maybe not. That was already a mouthful. Let's stop for a second. Usually this is where it's nice to have Luis, because I can like stop and bounce stuff off of him, or he'll come in with some other angle, or at least stop to like make fun of me or something. But without having him, I'm kind of have to more remember what the prices on cards are going to changing, because that's the stuff that I really look at. I mean, again, Go for the Throat is a good example of a card that you'd think would shoot out of the gate and be worth a lot more money than it was when it was released. Everyone kind of knows it's an answer. So I think people are definitely curtailing their decks accordingly. I mean, obviously all the Tezzeret decks are a little more immune to Go for the Throat. You've got Phyrexian Revoker out there somewhere and a bug. I think, so you haven't watched its value change. I still think it's a $2 card. I still think it's very playable and standard, which is really more the point right now. But I'm not at all surprised if the blue-black decks kind of run some kind of package combo where it's a 3-3, a 3-2. I mean, they're still running 4 Jace, despite the fact that it seemed like leading up to Besiege coming out, blue-black was probably playing 5 or 6 Jace total. Blue-white had kind of scaled up back a little bit because you were running a lot more versatile threats and more planeswalkers. I mean, the Gideon, Elspeth, Jace kind of combination is like the super best friends when they all come together. But Jace is back. He's a 4-of, which is pretty key for all of these things. But that way, you know, for the blue-black decks, you can get the right answer at the right time, as opposed to, you know, maybe being blown out by a Precursor Golem. Now, there's a card that I think still has a lot of room to grow. You know, 50 cents a week or two ago, it's already a dollar card. It's kind of like the cheaper Grave Titan. It's kind of like a great mid-range threat against a lot of decks. I mean, sure, Doomblade wipes it, Slagstorm wipes it, Divine Offering or Naturalize, those cards are playable this weekend. Offset, there are plenty of answers to it, which I think is one of the reasons it's kind of under the radar, but there are a lot of decks that just don't have a great answer to it up front. And if you're going to look at blue-black control decks with Go for the Throat as an answer, Precursor Golem's pretty sweet right there. In whatever deck, again, it's an artifact, so you can Tezzeret for it. You could make one of them a 5-5 in a pinch if you don't have nothing else going on, although I'm pretty sure those decks have other options. But I think it's a great card to grow. I mean, it's only a dollar. It makes 3/3/3s, and you have to have specific removal for it, which a lot of decks don't right now. Maybe after this weekend, it'll all be spoiled. It'll all be over. Maybe it won't even hit. But if I think there'll be a time there where you can play that card where people won't be ready for it. Unless, you know, Tezzeret decks are huge, and all of a sudden you see a lot of Divine Offerings and people's sideboards or main decks naturalizes cards like that. Lastly, on the same note, talking about artifacts, it's great to see some more of these Scars cards kind of going back up in value and being more playable. Mox Opal, which we were so down on at first when it came out, being like, oh, it's legendary, oh, you'll never be able to play it. It's got some sweet homes right now, especially in that Tezzeret deck, where you're going to be playing a lot of artifacts. You may or may not need the acceleration, but it still has utility in the fact that you can make it a 5-5 beater. Or late in the game, you're still going to want that mana and it's going to be good, but you got other value out of it, out of impulsing for it, or accelerating it or making a guy. So already Tezzeret is increasing the value of a card like Mox Opal. It's only going up recently and is seeing some action this weekend. Now, in the Kadatha Red decks, you've kind of had the option to play a certain number of Moxes and a certain number of Chimeric Masses. Those numbers have changed while I've been playing the deck, while people's interests and feelings have changed. But I think with more Signal Pests, you're going to see probably a two Mox Opal. I mean, that seems kind of like the number people are settling on in their decks. Aggressive or control, which is pretty cool for a card like Mox Opal. I think it speaks a lot to how well it was designed. If at the end of the day, the control decks and the aggro decks all kind of end up running the same number of this card. It's not like I really want four and I'm going to want it early and I'm going to maximize it versus, well, I want like one or two late in the game because it might do something. I think it's really well balanced and I'm glad to see it's getting some action. I mean, that's a pretty good amount of standard analysis on the new stuff. I mean, if you want to talk a little bit more or hear a little bit more about prices, I think that Hand of the Praetors, Skitherix the Blight Dragon are great cards right now because we're seeing more infect cards and we're going to be seeing more infect cards, so their value is going up. Their playability is right on the fringe right now. I know that PV in testing had an infect deck that he really liked and was pushing really hard to make playable for the Pro Tour. And while it didn't end up being his final choice, I do know that you've got to assume it's coming down the line, especially the more things come out slash kind of shift. And it's the same game we always play where it's like, well, you know, Fairies was pretty, you know, it was like it existed at one point, then it got better with this. And I think the kind of artifact decks are the same way. We're seeing them now. We might not see infect decks this weekend, but they're out there. I mean, Vatmother is obviously quality. Vatmother plus Hand of the Praetors, how convenient. Like, you lay Vatmother turn three or four, you know, minus or plus an accelerant. Turn five, maybe it's Hand of the Praetors. All of a sudden, you have a five power infect guy. You know, that's just kind of like natural with cards that are reasonable, worth playing. It's not like you're getting crazy trying to giant growth these guys. It's all pretty good. So, yeah, stuff like that, stuff to look for. There's stuff I'm missing out. That's the great part about Magic Weekend is there's so much going on that it's like I'm already behind the curve on what's current. But, you know, for your FNMs, for your events coming up really soon, I think it's valuable information. And I'm excited to see where it goes myself. I'm sad I sold a lot of my Mystics I'd been sitting on for quite a while, as now they are obviously pretty powerful. But yeah, I'll be glued to my computer screen for the rest of this weekend and excited to see how things turn out. Go Team Fireball, go Ben Stark right now. I know that he's doing really well as I'm recording this right now, but obviously good luck to the whole team. Connolly didn't bother to send me his deck list. I don't know what he's playing. Jeez, seriously, I'll have to grill him about that later. Probably doesn't have Blue Sun Zenith in it, despite the fact that that's what I asked for. But I could ramble on about that stuff for a while. Thanks for stopping by, listening to myself and Humphrey. Go Team Fireball, and thanks for watching.